bowing down to none or no one but Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth, who has no equal. No associates. And if you're associated with him, it's because he commanded it. Oh, brothers and sisters, I thank Allah so much for the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. My dear brother, Jibril, those who spoke today reading his brief summary of his great life and work, you could never summarize his life in a little pamphlet like this. You will love him more as you know him more. You will love him more as you learn more about who Jibril Muhammad is. Not only Jibril Muhammad, who he is with the nation of Islam, but who he is with Allah, and who directed him in the marvelous way that his life was fashioned. In the janazah service of Muslims, we don't do eulogies and we don't sing sad songs or do a lot of sad music. We don't do preaching, but not today. I want to talk about this unusual human being. Both of us born in the Bronx, New York, in the same hospital. Think about that. Morris Senior Hospital in the Bronx, New York. Myself, we had a deep love for God and love for our people and a great desire to see our people free, justified, and equal before the entire world. Both of us grew up. Our young years, we were in New York, and so was I. My mother took us to Bermuda and then to Boston, Massachusetts, where I went to school, and my brother Jibril was in New York going to school. And then one day, he met Brother Malcolm. It's not a coincidence. One day I met the same man, Malcolm X. Both of us were so positively affected by our meeting with Brother Malcolm. When I first heard him, I had already heard the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I took out my form and wrote a letter to get rid of a slave name. But like in all things, the enemy is always trying to make it more difficult than it should be. I never got an answer to my letter. So I went to New York, where I began a little work in show business. And there I went to the temple, like my brother, Jabril. The temple was a beautiful place for him and me and many, some of whom are right here in this room, that were nurtured into a totally new way of thinking, new way of acting, new way of life, with a new teaching from a new teacher, the most honorable and honored Elijah Muhammad. I want to talk about why I gave my brother the very beautiful name, Jabril. He didn't want Jibril. He said, I will accept it, but you gotta give it an A, Jabril. Now, you gotta ask him, how did you know the day, the month, the year that Elijah Muhammad would leave from among us on the heels of a death plot? Only he knows. And when something like that happens and a man comes up right, who would you give the credit to? See, sometimes we have knowledge implanted in us, given to us, shared with us by Allah through angelic forces. I called him Jabril because to me he was an angel. And he was my particular angel that God sent after me to bring me back to myself and to God. In life, you meet many people who you call your friends. When I met Brother Jabril, he put capital letters on the word friend. He put capital words on the name brother. He had an assignment. Most of us don't know much about scripture. And we're so messed up with the way Satan has put prophecy and made it history, and took history and made it prophecy. So we really needed a teacher to unravel the beauty of both Bible and Quran. So the Mahdi came, a flesh and blood human being. He came. Now the Quran tells you, you can try your best to interpret the Quran, and it gives us rules of interpretation, just so we'll be guided better in our desire to look into the Word of God. But Allah says it so clearly in the Quran, in Surah Al-Imran, it says, the Quran has verses that are decisive. The Quran has verses that are allegorical. And those in whose hearts is a disease, they take the allegorical part because they, you know, they want to claim something for themselves. And I know you know people like that. But then the Quran says, but none. I'm going to say it again. But none knows its interpretation but Allah. Listen. So I don't care what kind of scholar we think we are. And the scholars have messed up religion with much of their ignorant talk of what it means. None knows its interpretation but Allah. And then it says, and those firmly rooted in knowledge, they say. See, now some of you miss the punctuation. And those firmly rooted in knowledge, see, they're trying to put themselves slyly, slickly, demonically, where they don't belong. You don't belong interpreting a word that comes from Allah, except by His permission. So Allah clears up all stupidity by saying, none knows its interpretation but Allah. And I put a period there. Well, who the hell are you, Farrakhan, to put a period where the enemy had put a comma? Because I have been made wiser by God's permission than a scholar. You don't call me the minister for nothing. When you hear about the minister, your mind don't go to Reverend Chickenfoot. What comes out of your mouth is, oh, the minister, Minister Farrakhan. S- So, I put a period in place of the comma, and thus it reads like this: none knows its interpretation but Allah, period. And those firmly rooted in knowledge, they say, we believe in it. Notice the difference. It is all from Allah. But they're just believers. See, in a divine work, everybody got to know their place. And when you try to get into God's place when you belong somewhere else, you're making a tragic mistake. Cause many people to lose their lives with somebody playing God. Elijah Muhammad didn't play God. He met God. He was taught by God. And he grew up into God. So, my beloved brother lies here fulfilling the Quran. I'd like to read a few verses that I think rightly describing him. O soul that art at rest, return to thy Lord, well pleased and well pleasing. I had those verses from the Quran put in his casket. Because if you were blessed to see him in repose, in death, you would have to bear witness, man, he certainly looks just like he's sleeping. He certainly looks at I'm going to tell you something. To be dead in this world, everybody should be dying with a frown. Because in this world, we go out in the evil of this world, and it's hard on us. But when God has given you a reason for living and a purpose for living, and you fulfill that purpose, then dying is as easy as saying, Alhamdulillah, I finished my course. I have run my race. Now is laid up for me a crown. I called him Jibril because to me he was an angel of exquisite quality. I'm not going to be long, but I got to say what's on my heart. You know, there's a cyclical nature to history. Some may call it cyclical. History does repeat itself, even when you sometimes learn the lesson of it. When the circumstances are similar, the conditions are similar, the need is similar, then God acts and sends a messenger into the world. And sometimes that messenger is supported by an angel, and sometimes the messenger is an angel. Oh, wait a minute now. The Quran said, if you were an angel, I would send an angel for you. I was at the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's table one day, and I was sharing with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad an out-of-the-body experience that I had. I've had several of them that you're not physically present, but you can hear, you can see, without the use of the auditory nerves or the eyes, because you are in a state of mind spiritually where you travel. And so I was traveling, and I ended up in Rome. I'm not interested in encouraging your disbelief and your negative mind toward me. But when I got up the nerve to tell the Honorable Elijah Muhammad my experience, a lot of people were in the room, but they were all talking, and I talked to the messenger, you know, like sometime a little private, you know, conversation. He took his spoon and he hit the glass that is it's crystal, and it emits a sound. And when he hit that glass, and the believers around the table heard it, they got quiet. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said to the table, I want you to hear something that the minister has told me. I felt a little strange, because when you're not liked by people, not because you did anything wrong to them, they don't understand how God works. There were two young men One of them is in this room today. Bala Abdullah Yassin, a son of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, and Brother Kamal Kareem. These young boys, they were about 10 years old. And each of them could look in water and see things. Not a bug in the water, but transported through the water, through the water of their brain, to a place where they both see and hear. That young man, Abdullah Yassin, is here. And I knew him from a young boy. And while I'm on that subject, when we had dinner that evening, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad asked the question, why would two young boys, 10 years old, start looking in the water and seeing things? Why would God allow that? This is the messenger asking the question. And then he answered the question. He says, because he's making us into a nation of gods. You and I, in our present state of mind, we use the telephone, we use the television, and we use, the contraptions that white folks, and I thank them so much, because it is nice that we can see each other long distance. We're just tapping the phone, and all of a sudden, we're talking to somebody that we love. That's a big step. But in the world of the righteous, they don't need a phone. They can hear you. In fact, once the messenger knew, of course he knew long before I said it, that Allah was doing things with me, he told me one day, and it's in the book by Imam Sultan Muhammad, the writings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad from his table talks. He says, yes, brother, because of your spiritual understanding, you could look in on us, listening at you. And he's talking about how they were around the table listening to a tape of myself that they were listening to in Chicago. But then he's saying now, brother, you could listen in, looking at us, listening at you. I'm far beyond lying to you. I'm just telling you what he said. But he's telling me that we all have powers that come from this magnificent thing that we call brain. And sometimes you can see things and you wake up and you wonder, what was that about? Oh, look, I've been here before. I heard that conversation before. because you're the people of God. You don't know what God has put in you, but if you clean up your life, you get more acquainted with your real power.
Wow, brothers and sisters. That was something else. I'm telling you, that was the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. You were listening to him from Mosque Maryam, replaying a portion of the lecture that he gave for the janazah prayer service. Our dearly departed brother, Minister Jabril Muhammad, who left us July 16th. And this past weekend, we had the janazah prayer service. Brother James G., why don't you start off, brother? What did you get?
I mean, whenever you hear the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan speak, man, he just takes over. He takes you over, man, because not only the resonance of his voice, but the more importantly, the information that he brings, the revelations that he brings, you know. Many of us, some of the things that he was just saying, and before I go further, let me just say, if you were there or if you have a comment, call in now, 773-591-1690. There are many of you who were there over the weekend, 773-591-1690. And some of you may have known Brother Minister Jabril, or you might want to know a little bit more about him. So call in with your questions or comments. But to your point, my brother, you know, when a minister speaks, in that little short, 30-minute clip that you just played, there were so many gems that he dropped.
Yes.
That, you know, we sometimes don't even think about. As he was talking about, you know, I've heard that before, or I've been here before, and you can kind of reflect in your mind. I mean, that I have actually done that myself at various times over my life. Man, I've heard that before. I've seen that before. I couldn't place it, but it just brought something up in my mind. And so, you know, Brother Minister Jabril, I want to ask everybody, too, to make sure you buy a copy of the Final Call newspaper that just came out yesterday or this morning. It features a lot of information about Minister Jabril. And let me just a few of the headlines that gives you an idea of who this man is and was. An angel among us. The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan just referred to him as an angel. And he also talked about how history can repeat itself. And if you just examine the nation of Islam, just examine it. Put it under a microscope. Put the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's works, deeds, and actions under a microscope. Put the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan's works, deeds, and actions under a microscope, and then lay out the scripture on the other side of that microscope. And as you look through the scripture, you will see how history might repeat itself, but you will actually see the book unfolding right before your eyes in 2023, the things that are going on in the world, particularly as it impacts or affects the nation of Islam. An angel among men, he said. Another headline, it started from this man. Now, a lot of it, as you look in the paper, you're going to see how Brother Minister Jabril Muhammad was actually that angel he met, as it was historically Prophet Muhammad in his night journey through in a cave, he met the angel Jabril. Well, and he said, read. Well, that's exactly what happened in the history of the nation and in the minister's life. Brother Minister Jabril, and you will read this in the Final Call paper when you get it, went and searched for the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan after the nation fell. Something that the government of America planned and thought they had accomplished the fall of the Nation of Islam, just as they planned the assassination of many of our black leaders, including Malcolm X, which they tried to blame on the nation. But truth hidden in the earth will rise again.
That's right.
It started from this man. That's an interesting history. You got to read up on how Minister Brill was impactful in that. No greater bearer of witness is another headline. If I'm going too long, Brother BJ, tell me. So,
no, please, man.
I mean,
please,
sitting in Brother Naba's seat, and I don't know how to navigate it like he does. So just bear with me.
He says, go ahead. No greater
bearer of witness. This man, you know, Minister Jabril, he was kind of the guy when he wanted to be off to the side watching. And you might, you know, don't let it slip. He, you know, some people might have taken him for granted or not viewed him in the proper light. And hopefully I have viewed him in the proper light. But you might have thought he was just somebody over in the corner. But he was looking, man. He was
right. He was
a man. I mean, yeah. So a great,
very mysterious man.
Oh man, mysterious.
I always thought he was a mysterious man.
Mysterious, but very insightful. That you might think he's mysterious, but he's looking at you. He's reading you. He is reading.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. It says scholar. I mentioned that earlier. How he was. You know, he was on his research, his writings, Farrakhan the Traveler, Closing the Gap. I mean, you just got to get all of his stuff. Only the Chosen.
Yes, sir.
That's another headline. But there's many things. Brothers and sisters, go out, get that Final Call newspaper today, and read about what you're witnessing taking place in your midst as we speak. And there are a couple of callers. Maybe the engineer, Brother BJ, can we take a couple of callers before?
Yes, sir. Please.
Okay. My engineer will. Let's bring on Brother Barney. Assalam. Happy birthday, Brother Barney. Happy solar journey, another solar journey around the planet.
Go ahead, Brother Barney.
Wa alaikum salam. All praise is due to Allah for allowing me another year among you.
Amen.
You got me feeling like a buttered biscuit again, brother. I praise you.
Well, let me, before you go, let me put a little bit more butter on the biscuit so people can know who we're listening to. The Honorable Minister Farrakhan referred to Brother Barney as a watchman on the wall. So that means, you know, don't slip on Brother Barney. He might be up on that wall looking, but he's gonna bring to life whatever's happening. So bring it into the light. Go ahead, Brother Barney.
Oh, man, that's beautiful, brother. All praise to you. I really enjoyed the minister, as always. I was looking at the Final Call newspaper today, and I had noticed on page 16 there was a picture of the study group that we used to have at the Final Call back in the 80s.
Right.
And I really would like to see some of the original pictures, because those were the original days that Brother Jabril would do his original study guide when he was setting up those study groups around the country. And I think I still have one of the original study guides that he had. And it was written all over, you know, and one of the ones that I really remember from that first one was him talking about Peter at the gate, referring to the minister, and how Peter had denied Jesus. And he was standing at the gate as they were coming in. And there was a certain kind of condition he would have to have while he was greeting them. So there was a humbleness in that. Mm-hmm. And so our relationship with Brother Jabril, our ability to talk with him and study with him, I even had an opportunity on occasions as the minister would be at his home at 9415 Damon at that time and would say, go get Brother Jabril from here or there. Mm-hmm. And I picked him up one time from the airport. I said, well, brother, you don't have any luggage. And he was saying to me, no, brother, this is how you travel. He said, all I do is just stop by a laundromat. I'll show you how to clean your clothes, and then you right back roll it again. You have to carry a lot of clothes.
Wow.
So we were learning a lot of things from this brother. Yeah. And I know one thing, and I'll close on this one, is that he took a lot of pictures.
Everywhere you saw him,
he was taking pictures. So we pray a lot that at some point they will make those pictures available, because I'm sure he's got shots that nobody has.
Right. Yeah.
Thank you a lot for us, brother. Yeah. And Brother James, you're doing well in that seat. That's just right. Don't get too comfortable. That's may right. Allah bless.
Thank you, Brother Barney. May Allah bless you, man, with many, many more trips around the sun.
Oh, one other thing, uh-huh. Brother, if I can say this. Uh-huh. I don't want to forget this. What Brother Jabril was doing on the spiritual level, his wife, Dr. Bettina, was doing on the physical level.
Yeah.
And her ability to heal with the knowledge that she has. You know, I think I've told Brother James and others, they were trying to put me on the dialysis, the kidneys at 8%. And she began to work with me and the supplements and other things. And my kidneys began to go up. To 10%, 15%. Mm. So, and others who had stage 4 cancer were being cured. So Allah blessed his wife to have a portion of that great spirit that he had. So I just want to make sure that people understand that as we march on. We really need
wonderful.
To focus on his wife.
Yes, sir. Right. Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
Her name is Dr. Bettina Muhammad.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, brother.
Yes, sir. Brother James, we're going to take a break.
Yeah, okay.
Salam, Brother Barney. We're going to take a quick break, and we got some more phone calls. We can get to them before we get to Dr. Wesley after the top of the hour.
Okay.
Brothers and sisters, you are listening to Straight Words right here on WVON 1690, the talk of Chicago. Brother Nabar Richard Muhammad is out tonight. Brother James G is in the hot seat. I'm Brother BJ. And you can support us, brothers and sisters, because this is not free. And I'm telling you, if I had money in my wallet tonight and you hearing the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan and you hearing us on WBON and we are penetrating the hearts and minds of the people in the city of Chicago and all over the world with this life-giving message, brothers and sisters, why wouldn't you support something like this on the radio? Mm-hmm. Straight Words mm-hmm. on Cash App. That's $StraightWords. $StraightWords on Cash App. On Zelle, 312-480-9775. That's 312-480-9775. And on PayPal, it's StraightWords, the number 4@gmail.com. Brothers and sisters, don't hold back. Give, 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 so we can keep this life-giving message in the city of Chicago and all over the country and all over the world that are listening on WVON.com. We need this, brothers and sisters. We need this in this hour. So coming back
Anita.
Next hour, Dr. Wesley,
yeah.
Sir.
Anita will be up right before Dr. Wesley, right?
Okay. Okay. All right. So Anita, you stand by at 773-591-1690. Brother Wesley Muhammad will be joining us next hour right here on WVON 1690, the Talk of Chicago.
The Talk of Chicago is 1690 WVON, Sherwin, Chicago.
Dad! Come on! Over here! Look at this, Dad! Over... Whoa!
The moment my son saw a redwood tree...
It's huge!
...is the moment I knew that for him...
You can't even see the top of that thing!
Even the sky has no limit.
There are some moments only the forest can inspire. Find yours at discovertheforest.org. Learn about forests near you and discover cool things to do when you go, like hiking, biking, fishing, or camping. Or do your own thing when you get there with family and friends. Your moment is out there. Find it at discovertheforest.org. That's discovertheforest.org.
Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
The Talk of Chicago is 1690 WVON.
To the riot, Chicago. Trump is expected to be arraigned in the case on Thursday. And that's the latest. I'm Esther Dillard from the Black Information Network and BINnews.com.
I'm Vanessa Tyler.
And I'm Mike Stevens on your home for 24/7 news, the Black Information Network.
The legal hammer has dropped on Donald Trump.
Today, an indictment was unsealed, charging Donald J. Trump with conspiring to defraud the United States, conspiring to disenfranchise voters, and conspiring and attempting to obstruct an official proceeding.
That's special counsel Jack Smith. This indictment for election interference, Trump lost but lied, leading to the January 6th riot, although Trump was not charged with that. Legal observers say this case is strong.
This is the most serious case that has been brought against Donald Trump, and for one simple reason. It involves an allegation that the former president, when he was president, tried to subvert the peaceful transfer of power.
Assigned to preside over this case, a black woman, Obama-appointed Judge Tanya Chutkan, Trump due in court Thursday. This is the ex-president's third indictment, and another one is looming, election interference in Georgia. Trump dismisses it as an un-American witch hunt.
There's shock and mourning in New Jersey. The state's lieutenant governor has died one day after going into the hospital. African-American Sheila Oliver made history and broke glass ceilings. She also was the first black state assembly speaker. Born and raised in Newark, New Jersey, she dedicated 40 years to public service. The Democrat was loved and respected on both sides of the aisle.
And I was totally in shock. Sheila was a wonderful person. She helped so many. And I was so proud of her when she made the first black lieutenant governor. I was very proud.
She was acting governor while Phil Murphy is out of the country in Italy on vacation. The Senate president has stepped in now. Oliver has had health issues. Black lieutenant governor Sheila Oliver, dead at 71. It's 2023, but two black men say it felt like 1953 when a bus driver ordered them to the back of the bus. They were headed to downtown Fargo, North Dakota. They say the bus was empty when the white driver demanded they move and threatened to call cops if they didn't. The bus company, Jefferson Lines, reportedly responded, "There may be unique circumstances when a driver would ask a passenger to move, like for an elderly or disabled person." But the black men say that was not the case, and again, the bus was empty.
But in this case, a black woman refused to move, and it was 1944, back when blacks had to. We remember Irene Morgan Kirkcaldy. She was on a Greyhound bus. She argued she paid her ticket and was in the colored section when a white couple needed a seat. The driver told her and a black woman holding a baby to get up. She took her case against segregation and interstate travel up to the Supreme Court. One of her attorneys, a young Thurgood Marshall, and she won. This was 11 years before Rosa Parks. I'm Vanessa Tyler with Mike Stevens on your home for 24/7 News, the Black Information Network.
You've reached the last level. Heart racing with each obstacle encountered. Every press of the button timed to perfection. With only one life left, it would be a pretty bad idea to take your eyes off the game, right? So why would you take your eyes off the road when you're behind the wheel? Didn't think about that, did you? It won't kill you to put your phone down, but it might if you don't. Distracted driving, it's not a game. Visit itsnotagameillinois.com to learn more.
It's Matt McGill.
From Philadelphia, now on WVON, the one and only Vivian Green.
I love Chicago, so it's so funny. I've loved it since the moment I first visited. I'm a landscape scenery person. Mm. That does it for me. You learn about the Great Lakes in school. Mm. You learn all of them, and you just take the test and all that, but they don't really explain to you the vastness of them that they
that
appear
is
to
so
be.
That is so funny.
That so
is,
they appear to be oceans.
That is
so when I look out, yeah, it is really funny. I love telling this story. I tell it to the audience all the time. I'm like, I was looking out the window, and I was like so confused. Like, what the hell is that?
Weekdays at 1 p.m. on The Talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
Hi, this is Darlene Hill, co-host of WVON's afternoon show, Buchanan and Hill. Worried about your credit score? You can rebuild it. There are a lot of factors that go into determining your credit score, but one of the most effective ways to improve your score is to consistently pay your bills on time, over time. If you are forgetful about payments, try automating your bill payments. That way, all your creditors get paid on time, and you'll have freed yourself of trying to remember. Whatever your financial goals, U.S. Bank Access Commitment Initiatives can help support you in reaching them. Access your financial goals at usbank.com/access. Member FDIC, equal housing lender.
From the Xfinity Studios at WVON, we are the talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
WVON 1690, this is the talk of Chicago. Brothers and sisters, thank y'all for listening to Straight Words, featuring Brother Nabar Richard Muhammad, the editor of the Final Call newspaper. He's out tonight, but the former editor-in-chief is sitting in the hot seat tonight. Good brother, Brother James G. Muhammad. I'm Brother BJ, and I thank y'all so much for listening to us and supporting us on Straight Words. We've been on the air since May, and we're still going strong in the month of August. And we got a birthday to celebrate with Brother Nabob. We'll be doing an event, and hopefully he'll want everybody to come and gather together so we can be together in person in the city of Chicago. 773-591-1690, 773-591-1690. We got Dr. Wesley Muhammad, our good brother. The good brother doctor will be here with us talking about Malcolm X and the new developments in that $100 million case that the family, along with Ben Crump, is suing the city of New York and the NYPD. But Brother James G., yes, do you have some more people you want to get to?
Yes, sir. We got Anita on the line. We want to thank you, Sister Anita, for holding on. What's your comment?
Okay, Assalamualaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
My comment, you all were talking about the spiritualness. Abraham was told not to sacrifice his son, but his obedient Elijah Muhammad did not sacrifice black males. He was obedient and did what God told him to be a man, be a father, be a husband, do these things and protect the family. This is something the world does not do. This is why they don't like Elijah Muhammad, and they wanted him to be a man that loves another man like a woman. And he just was not into that at all. So God bless you all. You got the greatest example. He is following that scripture to the T. So, and Minister Farrakhan had wisdom to keep it going. Because I follow the man Warf Dean Muhammad, and trust me, Elijah Muhammad's son, Warf Dean by Clara Muhammad, was no punk, okay? Mm-hmm. And none of those children by Clara were punks, women or punks. They were beautiful people with a beautiful spirit, and I'm so glad we had that tradition, and I'm glad you all are courageous enough to come and say, hey, I'm proud of that.
Yes, ma'am.
I'm proud of that.
That's right.
And God is proud of you for protecting the father image of men. You see what they're trying to do to men today. I mean, they're trying to get kindergarten boys to convert to homosexuality in the public school. This is ridiculous.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes,
but
ma'am.
Anyway, may God bless Elijah Muhammad and his family and all of us that believe with him. Love you all.
Yes, ma'am. And
love you, sir.
Thank you, Sister Anita. Appreciate that comment. The Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, by all means, is definitely a standard that all men should seek to follow. He stands up, he represents, he's a wonderful father, not only to his own family, but to a nation. He's a father to a nation. And
that's right.
You know, many of our young men who are out there today who didn't have a strong father figure in their life adopted the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan as a father figure. And thanks to that, they've been successful in life. 773-591-1690. If you have a comment, please call us. If you went to the janazah service, give us a call. If you knew Brother Jabril and would like to make a comment, give us a call. If you want to know more about him, if you got a question, give us a call. Brother BJ, I know we're expecting Dr. Wesley. I don't know if he's called in yet. If he has not, I'm going to take Michelle. Okay, Brother VJ?
Yes, sir, please.
Because I don't see him on the board.
Good evening, brothers, and assalamu alaikum and wa alaikum salam to you.
Yes,
I appreciate hearing the minister every time, especially when it's new material, because I had no idea that was going on there, and it was just delightful. Mm-hmm. It was like a confirmation to the previous 3 hours, if you didn't catch it, brother, catch it on the replay.
Mm-hmm. He's right.
What the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan said, as you put it, this weekend, We just rehearsed it all over again on P-Ratio.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow. Wow. And so that's why I'm calling in and with this prayer and thought in mind. Everybody in the Nation of Islam ought to be feeding this show to keep it on the airwaves all over the country.
I would say they not only in the Nation of Islam, but out of the Nation of Islam as well, Sister Michelle.
Okay, that's fine. That. But, brother, I have a serious question and a prayer request, and I was wondering if one of you could maybe possibly whisper into Honorable Louis Farrakhan's ear that Michelle called in with this request.
Yes, ma'am.
And that is this. Mm-hmm. You all have a better relationship with our brothers from the Caribbean. Those that are migrating here from all over the world, they are being dropped in the west, on the west side and on the south side, and some of their dealings are notorious, and we know this. Mm. However, my request is that maybe some of you brothers can go into some of those neighborhoods, especially where our elders are, and gently, because you all have the rapport like nobody else, gently suggest that they relocate themselves to Skokie or to Evanston or to any one of them north side neighborhoods, get close to the... Do you know that the Skokie neighborhood is very generous, and so is Evanston, with regard to those reparations. Mm-hmm. And most of your wealthy attorneys, they either live in Skokie or they hang out there. And so since they're the ones that are foreclosing and trying to, you know, snatch people's property all over the place, coming right out of Skokie, why don't we suggest and urge our Hispanic population, our illegal immigrants, the new police force that your governor is planning to institute, have them go to Skokie rather than the south side and the west side, okay?
I hear you, Sister Michelle. Oh, well.
Thank you.
The word is out. The word is out, Michelle.
All right.
Put the word
Love
out.
You much. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Okay, 773-591-1690 is the number to call if you have a comment. Still waiting for Brother Dr. Wesley. I know those who are listening are anxious to hear from our brother, so God willing, we'll get him on the line very shortly.
Yes, sir.
We do have Cliff on the line. Cliff, thank you for joining Straight Words with Brother Naba Muhammad and B.J. Murphy. What's your comment? Well, it says Cliff, but I don't hear him. Okay, he hung up. All right, so Brother BJ, are we aware of what the issue is with our doctor?
Well, he's going to hit us up at about 15
early.
After, so he it's 15 after
early.
Now.
Okay, I'm sorry. That's
yeah, he should hit us up in a minute.
Like
but I wanted to make one comment in regards to Brother Minister Jabril. Mm-hmm. And I heard the minister say there's some men who do not know that they are angels.
Uh-huh.
And I'm so glad that he pointed that out, because a lot of people think that angels are these little white babies that fly around in the clouds.
Yeah.
And he said he was an angel of exquisite quality.
Uh-huh.
And I love the fact when he talked about how he, when he wrote the word friend, he wrote it in capital letters.
Yeah.
And when you saw those pictures of how he was hugging the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, you don't touch men like that.
Yeah.
Unless you, that the kind of brotherly love that was in that picture, you know, you don't see that anymore, man. We don't hold each other in each other's arms with that kind of brotherly love
We
used to.
That's right. I think we do have Dr. Wesley, and I don't know if Cliff, there is a Cliff. I'm gonna take Cliff real quickly, and then we're gonna get to.
Okay, there you go, brother. Thanks for taking my call. I'm a Lakem.
Yes, sir.
Listen, brother, I'll just be brief and get right to the point. Maybe you can respond to a little later after your guest. But for the most part, I am a Christian, and speaking of, giving our prayers to Brother Jamil and his family and his passing, or I'm not too familiar. The perspective coming from the Nation of Islam in reference to life after death. So just want to get a better explanation and an understanding from the brothers and sisters from the Nation of Islam, and even from the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, what happens after death, in comparison to Christians and their belief, what happens after death.
Yes, sir. That's a great question.
That makes sense.
That's a great question. I was thinking of that when Brother BJ mentioned what he had just said. So if you keep listening, we're going to answer that question. We got a very esteemed and honored guest that is going to be coming on in just a few short seconds, and he may even have something to add to that. And I'm talking about Dr. Wesley Muhammad. He's a member of our Executive Council Shura of the Nation of Islam. He's a scholar in Islamic studies. I don't want to mess up his introduction. So I'm going to let him come on and just say a few words about himself, and then we'll get into a conversation with our great Dr. Brother Wesley Muhammad. As-salamu alaykum, Brother Dr. Wesley.
Wa alaykum as-salam, sir. How are you?
I am a blessed man. All praises due to Allah. And how are you?
Is my sound okay?
Man, you're coming through loud and clear on my earphones.
Powerful.
Great.
Yes, sir.
So, coming through with power, brother.
Yes, sir. So, Doc, give us just a brief background on yourself. I know you got pages that you could say, but just give us a few
points.
Yeah,
I never like to do that. I never. Just FYI to all who would invite me. But I never like talking about myself and introducing myself like that. I'm just your brother.
Yeah.
I'm striving to be a helper of the Messiah, the Honorable Brother Minister Farrakhan, one. A helper that Allah is pleased with, and I would know that he is by finding pleasure with the Honorable Brother Minister Farrakhan.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Well, we thank you for coming on. Unfortunately, Brother Naba is not with us on today. He's taking a well-deserved few days rest, but we're glad that you're on. And so let's just jump into the conversation. I know that at least one thing we're going to talk about is the recent press conference that Attorney Ben Crump and the family of Malcolm X and others who were at actually at the assassination of our dear brother had a press conference, and they're bringing another lawsuit against the government for their involvement. And I don't even know why we're even talking about, as a community, was the government involved when we have so much evidence that they not only were involved, but they orchestrated the whole thing. So, Dr. Wesley, what do you have to offer on this issue?
Well, the reason the case of the government's involvement has to continuously be made is because the government has so successfully convinced black people of the government's cover story.
Mm-hmm.
Government's cover story is that the Nation of Islam killed Malcolm X.
Yes.
And the government has gone out of its way, expended a lot of time, money and effort to sell that false narrative to black people. And unfortunately, that false narrative has made too much headway with our people. So the case has to be made convincingly to the world, but especially to black people, that the Nation of Islam is innocent of Malcolm's murder, that the U.S. government, multiple agencies thereof, were responsible for the death of Malcolm X. They instigated it, They organized and they executed it. So I am hopeful. I would hope that this case, this recent case that Attorney Ben Crump is filing on behalf of the Shabazz family, I would hope that it actually goes to court. I would hope that we have the type of historical moment similar to what happened in Memphis, Tennessee in 1999 when the government was sued for their involvement in the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King. And the case was made in court. Witnesses were deposed, and because of that 1999 case in Memphis, we know what happened to our brother Martin Luther King Jr. And the government, the jury, held the U.S. government responsible for that assassination. I would love to see this legal drama, if you will, play out in court. I would not hope that the court, that the case is settled out of court, because then the truths that need to be exposed in a court of law will have no chance to see the light of day, not in a court of law. So I would hope that it's not settled out of court. I would want this case to go to court. That would be a very...
Yes, sir. And so there was the recent press conference that you indicated that Ben Crump held, and I guess some, you know, maybe not, yeah, some new information may have come up, some new witnesses to the event might have come up. And then you had offered something on one of your podcasts that I found very interesting that could be of help in the case. Can you just talk a little bit about what the attorney presented and some of the things that came out of their press conference?
Yes. This particular press conference introduced a new, not a new witness, because we knew brother. He's front and center in the photos of Malcolm laying prone on the stage of the Audubon Ballroom. Most might not know his name, but we see him. He's in several of the pictures. That all of us who research the case of Malcolm X, we have all of these photos in our library. He's right there. So we know the brother, but we have never heard the brother until now, the brother Mustafa Hassan. And so he's the new witness providing testimony of what he recalls on that day. And while his observations of the assassination itself weren't different than what we already have, he did provide a very relevant detail that if you have the right data, you can make sense of the detail that Mustafa Hassan provided in his new testimony, that detail being what he heard from a police officer as he, Mustafa Hassan, and other followers of Malcolm had the fleeing assassin Talmadge Hayer in their grips, and they're beating him. And the two police officers are trying to rescue Talmadge Hayer from the crowd, and Mustafa Hassan overhears, he's one of those who's beating on Talmadge Hayer. He overhears one of the two cops say to the other, "Is he one of ours?" Now, that's important for reasons suggested at the press conference and for reasons not suggested at this press conference. Of course, Mustafa Hassan and attorney Ben Crump drew out the logical implications, and attorney Hamlin, the co-counsel with Ben Crump, I believe that's his name, Hamlin. They drew out the obvious implications of that. The officer indicating that he knows that some of the assassins were with them, yes, with the NYPD, yes, worked for them. And he wanted to know, is this one that we are rescuing, is this one of ours? Now, what I mentioned in my comments regarding a press conference is there were two men caught outside the Audubon Ballroom on 166th Street, outside the 166th Street exit, where Thomas Hare was caught. A group of police were rescuing Thomas Hare, but not too far from where the area we saw on that stock video that Attorney Crump showed. Not far from where Thomas Hare was being beat up and rescued, a second fleeing assassin was also caught by the crowd and was being beat up and was being rescued. The officer who said, is this one of ours, he was looking for that second suspect, because that second suspect was one of theirs. And that second suspect was the one designated to be rescued and disappeared.
Mm.
And he did. He was rescued and he was disappeared.
It's interesting, Doctor, that a couple of things. One was that the brother who brought this information forward was never contacted by the police or anybody to, as far as I understand, you know, to find out what he saw, what happened, because he was one of Brother Malcolm's security people, right?
That's correct.
Mm-hmm. And so that's
that particular account we hear quite frequently. Several key witnesses, persons whom you would expect would have been questioned by the police, they were not. Now, there could be multiple reasons for that, all of them very conspiratorial. There was an inside team that was critical to the success of the assassination of Malcolm X. By inside team, I mean followers of Malcolm X, close lieutenants of Malcolm X. I call it the Judas team, kill team one, the Judas team. I identify the shooter team, the five brothers, or the five men who actually shot Malcolm. I call that kill team two, the shooter team. Kill team two could do what it did only if and when kill team one did what it was supposed to do, the Judas team. Those were the brothers around Malcolm, his close lieutenants who betrayed him, who was responsible for the security stripping that made it possible for five men with guns to walk into the ballroom and shoot Malcolm down. It was an inside job that is responsible for that. So because kill team one, the Judas team, did their job effectively, Kill Team 2, the shooter team, was able, unfortunately, to do their job effectively. Yeah. Now, I had said in my comments, I'm interested in who gave Mustafa Hassan, the witness, the instruction that prematurely relieved him of his post on that day. He was an usher.
Yes.
He was one of the ushers in the aisle that seated the guests. Before Malcolm came out, he was relieved of his post and sent to the back of the Audubon Ballroom. Now, there were two important areas in the Audubon on that day, the kill zone and the safe zone. The kill zone was the stage. Normally, whenever Malcolm X spoke at the Audubon, the stage was full of people. Him plus at least four guards, armed guards, on stage with him, with their weapons, not counting the rostrum guards that were on the floor in front of the stage. There was normally four rifle-wielding guards on stage with Malcolm, and then there were the other speakers. So the stage where Malcolm spoke was always well-populated. But on that Sunday, because the stage was the designated kill zone, the stage and right in the front of the stage was the designated kill zone, everybody had a reason to move out of the kill zone right before kill time arrived. Kill time was 3 o'clock. And everybody found a reason, an excuse, to not be in the kill zone at that time. Most of them, they found their way to the safe zone, way in the back. And so when Mustafa Hassan says that before the assassination began, while he was, his post was as an usher in one of the aisles, he was told to leave his post and go into the back of the ballroom in the safe zone. I'm interested in who gave him that instruction, and when we find out, we will find out one of the inside men.
That's right. That's an excellent question, too, that I was going to ask you about. But there's one other question I have before we bring Art. He may have a question for you. He's on the line. You mentioned about two men who backed out of an assassination attempt and what happened to them. Can you briefly kind of talk about that?
Yes, a very interesting case, a very illuminating case in terms of why we should not be deceived by the fact that the shooters of Malcolm were black and had some affiliation with the Nation of Islam. By staying there, we're grasping that low-hanging fruit. They're the puppets. Who are the puppeteers? This particular case illustrates and identifies, helps us to see who the real puppeteers are, at least on one level. In this particular case, which we first heard about in 1966, an important investigation from Now magazine, they uncovered this early assassination plot against Malcolm. This was sometime before the February 21st, 1965 hit. It was sometime before February 21st. Two black Muslims, two FOI, were contracted to kill Malcolm. We aren't told who contracted them, but the story gives us a hint
of the powers involved. These two black Muslims who were contracted to kill Malcolm X on the day of the hit, they got cold feet. They decided they couldn't go through with it. They were supposed to shoot Malcolm. Now, of course, we don't carry or use guns in the Nation of Islam. These two brothers who were contracted to kill Malcolm and then got cold feet, they called the contract man, the man that paid them to kill Malcolm, called him, told him they can't go through with it. The contract man says, okay, no problem. Just go home and wait. Don't do anything. Wait for further instructions. Of the two men, one of them was suspicious of that instruction. So before going home, he called home. His wife answered. And he can hear from his wife, her tone, and the hints that his wife was giving him. He heard, don't come home tonight. Mm-hmm. So he didn't. Mm-hmm. The other black Muslim didn't have the benefit of that inside and advanced knowledge. So he went right home as instructed. And when he got home, waiting for him was the New York police. They arrested him because they found, as they expected to find on his person, the gun that he was supposed to use for the hit on Malcolm. Mm-hmm. They arrested him for violation of the Sullivan Law, having a loaded gun on him, and put him in prison. Mm-hmm. That was the consequence of their backing out of the hit that they were contracted for on Malcolm X. The one who did not go home, he avoided that trap. But that lets you know who was pulling the strings on this whole operation. Mm-hmm. The five-man shooter team that showed up at the Audubon on February 21st, they too were contracted to kill Malcolm. They carried out the contract, unfortunately.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Brother Dr. Wesley, so these men that were all involved, we considered them, they were agents, even though we said they had affiliation with the NOI. Could you kind of unravel that so the people would know a distinction?
Yeah. They had various and varying degrees of relation to the Nation of Islam. They had historic, at some point, all of them were active members of the Nation of Islam, but not necessarily at the time they carried out that hit. Two of the most well-known assassins, William Bradley, the shotgun shooter, the one who wielded the shotgun and actually delivered the steel shot. Malcolm was killed by the two blasts from that double barrel shotgun. The shooters that came up after that fact and pumped bullets into Malcolm's prone body, that was because this was intended to be an overkill operation. That was intentionally excessive. But Malcolm was failed by the shotgun blast. The shotgun assassin has been identified as William Bradley. He's the one who not only had the shotgun, but had the big, thick beard. He at one time was a lieutenant in the Nation of Islam, but he was put out of the mosque at that time.
so too was Talmadge Hare, the assassin that got caught at the scene of the crime and did time. He too was on F time. They were put out of the Nation of Islam at that time due to infractions of our law. Now, William Bradley, in addition to not being an active member of the Nation of Islam at the time, he had been and continued to be an intelligence asset, not just through the NYPD, but higher than the NYPD. He was a Green Beret converted from the Marine Corps. He was such a good Marine, he was tapped to get special training from the Green Beret School. Now that he was honorably discharged, he was sent to Muhammad Mosque or Muhammad Temple number 25 in Newark, New Jersey. He was a bona fide intelligent asset, the shotgun killer. So he wasn't pulling the trigger on behalf of the Nation of Islam or as a Nation of Islam member. He was pulling the trigger as an agent of the United States government. Mm. He was the pillar of that kill team too. The shooter team, he was a bona fide U.S. government intelligence asset of high rank.
Yes, sir. You're listening to Dr. Wesley Muhammad, a member of the Nation of Islam research team, a scholar. Brother Wesley, I don't know if you take a call. We have Art on the phone, on the line. Would you take a call or a comment from Brother Art?
Sure.
Brother Art, go ahead with your question or comment. He's been there for a minute, so can we get Brother Art up? Art, are you there?
Assalamu alaikum. Yes, I am.
Yes, sir.
Wa alaikum salam.
Yes, sir. There's a question maybe both of you can ask, because this whole thing with Malcolm X and what went on around that whole situation has been going on for so many years, 20, 30 years or whatever the amount of time. With the crime that's going on in our community, the killing and the murder, women shooting women, men shooting, people being assassinated by each other in our own community, with the broken family and the chaos, the disjointness, the lack of a community code of conduct, family value system, with all the mayhem that goes on in our own community, why we don't focus our energy specifically on rebuilding, restrengthening, restructuring the black community and the black family, and put all our resources, put all our chips and bet it on rebuilding and restrengthening the family? It just seems like at this juncture, when it comes to this situation with Malcolm X on both sides, even though everybody with any common sense know that the government has something to do with 90% of everything that goes on when it comes to leaders and things of that nature, what is going to be the end result? I mean, to think we're going to get any so-called justice in any court system that's ran by what we consider the white man or whatever we want to call it. I mean, to me, it just seems like our energy is not focused on what is immediately necessary. Our community is having a massive heart attack, a massive stroke. We need the real help, the real teaching, the real influx of time and energy and resources in our own community. Okay. Because right this here, not going to do anything for our black community, not one thing. If they come out and say the government did it, they're responsible. Okay.
Thank you, Brother.
Where we go from here? Yeah. And what now?
Thank you for the question, my brother. Dr. Wesley, would you have any response?
Absolutely. Dear Brother Art, are you still on the call?
I think it dropped.
Okay.
But you can call back if he can.
Well, no, I would want to know, ask the brother what his background is. Mm-hmm. If he's a Christian, I would understand him having that, the first part of that question in terms of focus, affecting that maybe to his pastor. He must not be familiar with the Honorable Brother Minister Farrakhan and the Nation of Islam, mm-hmm. because everything that he cited that we should focus on exactly. is precisely what the Nation of Islam focuses on and has for 90 years. It's very curious that only when we in the nation now have forced ourselves into the national conversation about Malcolm X, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan, who is best positioned and best qualified to talk about that man. And he has been revealing the insider perspective of what happened for decades now. But the mainstream Malcolm X narrative marginalizes the minister's testimony, absolutely marginalizes it. So the Malcolm X false narrative has gone on and is applauded, is accepted, is celebrated by most black people. And no one until recently ever hears the Malcolm X scenario come up and then object to why are we talking about Malcolm X. You only hear that now that we, the Nation of Islam, have bogarted our way into the national conversation and we are effectively dismantling the false narrative, the narrative that See, Brother Art said, yeah, we all know that the government has some involvement. That ain't sufficient.
Right.
Because the magicians of this false narrative, they got so slick where they are saying whenever evidence, new evidence of government complicity is revealed, the spinners of the false narrative then say, well, yeah, the government was involved, but they partnered with the Nation of Islam and the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Yeah. See, they insist on making the nation the villain of this false Malcolm X narrative.
Right.
So are dismantling that narrative, and only now you hear black people saying, why are we talking about Malcolm X? You ain't never heard that before. It's because you want to hold on to the false narrative that you are wedded to, and you are annoyed by the fact that we are consistently, successfully dismantling it. Now, as I am on this call at 10 o'clock at night on Tuesday, how do you know, Brother Art, that I didn't spend my day before 10 o'clock tonight focusing on everything you said we should focus on?
Yes, sir.
Why would a 10 o'clock at night radio show so disturb you?
Yes, sir.
Whatever the topic is. But it is because it is that topic. It is the topic in the way we are robbing you of the narrative that you are wedded to. This is what is annoying you.
Brother Dr. Wesley, you got the lines kind of smoking up here. I'm going to run through a few calls, if you don't mind.
Yes,
we have a great brother. His name is Brother Naba Muhammad. It seems like he's on the line. Brother Naba, are you there?
The great Naba Muhammad.
That great one. Yes, sir. I think he's on. Brother Naba, can we get Brother Engineer line one? There you go.
Assalamualaikum.
Wa alaikum salam, sir.
Brothers, I tell you, I wasn't feeling well. Man, I wasn't feeling well, Brother Wesley, but, you know, seeing the team do their thing and hearing you do your thing has really, it forced me to have to call in, and I'm going to try to make this quick, right?
No, brother, we're happy to hear from you.
But it goes back, Brother Wesley, to exactly what you are talking about. The enemy has told a lie so often for so long. And black people have gone for that lie, hook, line, and sinker, for so long, and have attached it to the Nation of Islam, and in particular, Minister Farrakhan, but only after he started rising to rebuild the nation.
That is a fact.
There was never any talk of Louis Farrakhan being involved in anything.
That's
at the time
right.
that Brother Malcolm was unfortunately killed.
Right.
But so we need to be clear on accuracy and a manipulation of the enemy. And if there ain't nothing to hide, why doesn't the federal government release all of the files which the minister
That's
has
right.
called for from the beginning?
Yes, sir.
That's right.
Why now, somewhat 50 years after Brother Malcolm's murder? Mm-hmm. Let's be clear on that. Murder,
right.
assassination by the enemy. Why you still got the books closed, yeah. federal
right.
government? Why you still got the books closed, NYPD? But the main people that the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan told me that got the files that show everything is the feds.
Right.
So if we right. already know, why don't you let it go?
Amen.
Right.
But the failure to stay current with history, man, is dangerous.
Right. Absolutely.
In 1995, when I had the honor of serving under Brother James T. Muhammad as a managing editor, he was my beloved editor-in-chief, I went to Minneapolis, Minnesota,
yeah.
where Kabila Shabazz
yeah.
was basically pulled into a trap by the feds, man.
Right. That's right.
And they said that she was part of a plot to kill Minister Farrakhan.
Right.
1995.
Right.
They
right.
blew it up all over everywhere. I happened to be with the minister as this thing unfolded at the palace. I don't remember why I was there, but I watched him. And when he made his statement at the mosque, in response, because he didn't, well, his first response was to send out Brother Leonard Farrakhan Muhammad, his chief of staff, and Brother Leonard came out with a message from Minister Farrakhan, where the minister said, the FBI ain't never been my friend.
Right.
And he said, I
right.
don't want nothing to happen to the family of Brother Malcolm.
Right.
And if anything
right.
happens to the family of Brother Malcolm, I'm going to hold you, the federal government, responsible, because you are again trying to do what you did before.
Right.
I was in the minister's words were so strong that he basically killed the case. So I went to Minneapolis because that's where she was charged, and integral to the case was Jewish informant Michael Kilpatrick.
That's right.
Huh?
That's right.
That lured this young woman into something. But when I called headquarters, Justice Department, they wouldn't touch it. So you mean to tell me you got an indictment against the daughter of Malcolm X for the for a plot to kill Farrakhan, but the main office don't have nothing to say?
Right.
You telling me talk to, I believe the man's name was David Lillehog in Little Minneapolis. My point, and I'm going to wrap this up in 30 seconds. Every time, as you said, Brother Wesley, we want to know everything because we have nothing to hide.
Right.
In 2021,
right.
two men, Muhammad Aziz and Khalil Islam, were exonerated and received a $36 million settlement.
Right.
In addition to the decades they spent behind bars.
Right.
And we had. Then we had, hold on a minute, because I want to get it right. In 2021, right? 2021. We had Raymond A. Wood's nephew come forward
right?
Right, Reggie Wood.
Who Raymond A. Wood, who was a black undercover detective with NYPD in the 60s. He infiltrated black groups to arrest and discredit them.
Right.
This man gave a confession to his nephew that, again, excuse me, Bugs, I'm sorry.
No.
That implicated NYPD. So, lastly, Dr. Betty Shabazz spoke at the Million Man March.
Right.
After the charges were killed because of the minister, there was a beautiful meeting held at the Apollo Theater in New York. And it was the beginning of reconciliation between the family of Brother Malcolm and the Nation of Islam. And you've never seen a more beautiful thing. Because this wound has been a fracture in our community. For every time we work on it, we clean that wound. And we point the enemy, we point the finger at the enemy that remains our enemy to this day. And with that, I'm done, brothers. Thank you for being with me.
Yes, sir.
I didn't mean to
go
call
ahead, go ahead.
I got my fire extinguisher out, brother. Nah, but you just lit
man,
it up.
Bro. Y'all doing it, man.
Yes, sir, man.
Hey, you ain't going nowhere now.
I know we're coming up on the top of the hour, but just real quickly, I know we got about four people on the line, brother.
But I have to say something, brother.
We're going to hold them over.
Yeah.
If Dr. Wesley can hold over for next hour for a couple of minutes before we go to our next segment. Could you do that, Doc?
Yes, a few minutes, but I want to say something regarding what our brother Nabba. Nabat said before we move on. Is that possible?
Yes, we got about 30 seconds, brother. We got to go to the top of the hour, Dr. Wesley.
But you can go to the break. And then when you come back, I will.
Okay. All right. Praise be to Allah. All right, brother Dr. Wesley Muhammad, brother Nabat, he's with us. You ain't going nowhere. Stay on the line, brother Nabat. Of course, brother James G. Muhammad, we are here, y'all. This is Straight Words, and you can only get it on WVON on Tuesday night. And we want you to support it. I mean, where are you going to hear this fascinating, revealing information about Malcolm X? And this information, one day, brothers and sisters, that Dr. Wesley has compiled and the Nation of Islam has compiled is going to liberate the soul of Black America when they finally hear the truth coming from us. So Straight Words on Cash App, you've got to support this message. Straight Words, $ Straight Words on Cash App. On Zelle, 312-480-9775, 312-480-9775. On PayPal, StraightWords, the number 4@gmail.com. Your phone call's coming up, and more with Dr. Wesley Muhammad right here on WVON 1690, The Talk of Chicago.
Zuberry, Karen, Smoking Joe, I need to hold on.
The Talk of Chicago is 1690 WVON, Berwyn, Chicago.
When you were a little kid and you thought about what you wanted to be, teaching was at the top of your list. But things changed. And as you got older, teaching didn't seem like the best option anymore. So you're thinking you'll be something else. But what would your 12-year-old self say? Now you want to be a doctor. You don't think teachers save lives? 25 at a time. An actress? Try playing a different role every time the bell rings. How about a scientist? Ever heard of physics? Chemistry? Who do you think teaches that? Teachers today are breaking down obstacles, finding innovative ways to instill old lessons, and taking learning far beyond the four walls of the classroom. It's time to recognize that great things are happening in teaching and put it back on your list. Don't try to convince yourself otherwise. You had it right the first time.
Find out how you can make more at teach.org. Make more. Teach. Brought to you by Teach and the Ad Council.
Latest, I'm Esther Dillard from the Black Information Network and BINnews.com.
I'm Terry McCrae.
McCready.
And I'm Kevin Brown on your home for 24/7 News, the Black Information Network.
The canine officer in Ohio who released a police dog on a black truck driver who was surrendering has been fired.
Do not release the dog with his hands up. Don't get the dog off of it.
Documents obtained by CNN showing Ryan Speakman's termination from the Circleville Police Department came after his alleged frequent discussions about the encounter with family and colleagues, and he's also accused of lying to the police chief about sharing the information. He released his police dog on 23-year-old Jadarius Rose last month following a lengthy vehicle chase that was sparked after officers attempted to pull over Rose's commercial semi-truck, which police say failed to stop for an inspection. The Ohio Patrolman's Benevolent Association, which is representing Speakman, says he was terminated without just cause.
A state panel in New York is revisiting efforts to expand African American history in public schools. The action comes following last year's shooting massacre at a grocery store in Buffalo, where 10 black people were killed. State Senator Leroy Comrie told the New York Post the white 19-year-old gunman had no formal education about black American history outside of the basics such as Martin Luther King Jr., and that people need to understand impacts and human commonalities. The commission was assembled in 2005, and recommendations on ways to improve the public school black history curriculum were issued years later, but the plans stalled.
The Biden administration is forming a new Office of Long COVID Research and Practice to study the condition and assist those affected. White House Coronavirus Response Coordinator Dr. Ashish Jha discussing the long-term impact of the illness.
We know that COVID can cause vascular damage, can damage the lining of the blood vessels.
The Health and Human Services Department says the office brings together federal resources along with state and local partners to answer the American people's most urgent calls to action. Long COVID occurs when patients still have symptoms at least 4 weeks after they've cleared the infection. The HHS estimates that anywhere from 7.7 million to 23 million Americans have developed long COVID after being infected with the virus.
As a federal investigation continues, along with a looming civil lawsuit, Memphis Police Chief C.J. Davis is now the subject of intense scrutiny because of her $280,000 salary. Memphis City Council Vice Chairman J.P. Smiley Jr. said the 14% increase was an incentive for further officer recruitment and retention. He says he and his colleagues were unaware the command staff would also receive the same increases. Davis' salary was just under $235,000 when she was hired 2 years ago, and now she earns about $100,000 more than Mayor Jim Strickland. Meanwhile, new officers earn $54,000 a year, up from $42,000. For more on these stories and international, national, state, and local news affecting the black community, listen to the Black Information Network on the iHeartRadio app. Or log on to BINnews.com.
I'm Terry McCready, along with Kevin Brown, on your home for 24/7 News, the Black Information Network.
I'm Keith Urquhart. On the Black Information Network, John Mercer Langston was the first black man to become a lawyer when he passed the bar.
Hi, this is Darlene Hill, co-host of WBON's afternoon show, Buchanan and Hill. We all can fall into the trap of mindlessly spending sometimes. One tip for staying on track is when you have an impromptu purchase that comes up, try making a habit of taking a quick look at your bank account balance before you buy it. It's not just about seeing how much you have in your checking account. Just looking at your account might put the urge to make that impulse purchase into perspective and help you make choices that'll benefit you in the long term. Whatever your financial goals, U.S. Bank Access Commitment Initiatives can help support you in reaching them. Access your financial goals at usbank.com/access. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
Hey Alexa, play WVON 1690 AM.
Getting WVON 1690 AM station from iHeartRadio.
Try it out for yourself. America is listening to WVON.
Take a look under your bed. Find stuff under there? What about jobs? No? Now try your basement. There's a pair of overalls that overall you're not so into anymore. A perfectly good laptop that hasn't sat in your lap in months. And even more stuff, but still no jobs? Well, you really have both. See, stuff is defined as household articles considered as a group. Sometimes this stuff is no longer needed. Wait, no longer needed? That can't be right. Because remember those jobs you were looking for? Those are really needed, and they're the stuff inside your stuff. Even inside that winter coat that moved with you to Phoenix. Our job is to unlock those jobs, and it starts when you donate your stuff to your local Goodwill. Here's how we do it. When you donate to Goodwill, we sell your stuff to provide job training for people right here in your community. So just by teaming up with Goodwill, you help create jobs. And isn't that worth parting with the leftover keytar from your 80s cover band? Goodwill. Donate stuff, create jobs. Find your nearest donation center at goodwill.org. A message from Goodwill and the Ad Council.
From the Xfinity Studios at WVON, we are the talk of Chicago. 1690 WVON.
WVON 1690, this is the talk of Chicago. You're listening to Straight Words. We come to you every Tuesday night from 9 until midnight Central Time right here on WVON. And brothers and sisters, we are having a wonderful show tonight. My name is Brother BJ. Of course, the host of the show is Nambar Richard Muhammad, the editor of the Final Call newspaper, former editor-in-chief, on the line with us as well. A guest hosting every week with us is Brother James G. Muhammad. And with that, we got Dr. Wesley Muhammad, our dear brother, who's a researcher and scholar, has written many books, and he's going to tell you all about that. But right now, the conversation is about Malcolm X and the new information that has just come out of, regarding the $100 million lawsuit with Ben Crump and the family of Malcolm X. And let's continue with that conversation there, brother.
Yes, sir. Well, I will drop off momentarily, but I just wanted to, because our great brother Nabob mentioned Officer Raymond Wood and his confession, as it was deathbed confession, if you will. That was revealed in 2021 through his cousin, Reggie Wood. I wanted to let the people know this Thursday, I will have Brother Reggie Wood on my show, opening the files with Dr. Wesley. I'm going to, Brother Reggie Wood and myself will have a conversation about the disclosures of Officer Raymond Wood, in addition to that written confession that Officer Ray Wood left and asked Reggie Wood to share after his death. Over the years, Ray Wood disclosed many details to Reggie Wood. Very important details regarding what he knew of the assassination of Malcolm X. He was at the Audubon Ballroom that Sunday. So Reggie Wood will join me on my show this Thursday at 7 p.m. Central. You can view the show opening the files with Dr. Wesley. You can view it on my YouTube page at Wesley Muhammad and my Facebook page at Dr. Wesley Muhammad. That's 7 o'clock this Thursday, 7 p.m. Central Time.
Good stuff.
Very good. Brother Wesley, this is Brother Naba. Can you text me that information? Because we certainly want to spread it.
And I certainly will.
We want to do that. Yes, sir.
Well, thank you, dear brothers. This was awesome. It always is.
Dr. West, I know you're getting ready to go, but just if you can, real briefly, I told the brother I'd have you comment. And you might have heard his question earlier about life after death. I think he was seeking some information or understanding of how the nation viewed that as opposed to how maybe Christians view it.
Yes, sir. Well, we in the Nation of Islam are taught by the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad that there is life after mental death,
there is life after spiritual death. And of course, that is why Allah traveled 9,000 miles to come to the United States of America to raise up a dead people, a people mentally, spiritually, culturally, socially, economically dead. He came to raise us up. Now, there is no physical life after physical death. As the Bible instructs, let the dead bury the dead. Once we are dead physically, there is no further continued personal existence in a heaven in the sky if we have been righteous, or a hell somewhere in the earth if we have been unrighteous. No, that's slave teaching. That particular understanding of heaven and hell and life after death is part of the slave master's shaping of Christianity for the slave. So we work hard to live right. We are taught in the Nation of Islam to do our best to live righteously, live in accord with the will of Allah. And by doing so, Allah has promised us what most would consider heaven. He promised us luxury, money, good home, friendships, and all walks of life. But the promise, that the promise is to be fulfilled while we are physically alive. Once we are buried in the grave, we will have no need of money, no need of luxuries, no need of friendships in any walks of life. We will coexist with the insects of the ground for a while until decomposition totally overtakes us. Yes, that's the reality in terms of physical death. But if we have lived a life worth remembering, if we lived a life that creates a legacy for us, if we have lived for a purpose beyond ourselves individually, then we will have life after death through our legacy.
Yes, sir.
Through the children who will physically continue our legacy, and through our work that will keep our name ringing down the wheels of time, inshallah. That's true life after physical death.
Yes, sir. Good teach, brother.
Thank you, brother. Dr. Wesley Muhammad, thank you very much for joining us. We know you have to go 7 p.m. What day is it? Tomorrow?
It's Thursday.
Thursday on your YouTube channel at 7 o'clock, 7 p.m. Central at Wesley Muhammad on YouTube and Facebook.
On YouTube and Facebook. Yes, Dr. Sir. Wesley Muhammad on Facebook, Wesley Muhammad on YouTube.
Yes, sir. We'll be tuning in. Thank you so much for joining us and sharing the wisdom that you have shared with us, brother.
Thank you. Thank you all. Love you
all.
Thank
you, Dr. Wesley. Love you too, sir.
Alaykum salam.
Wa alaykum salam, sir.
Hey, brother BJ, we got like three callers that have been holding, and then we have Pastor Victoria on. Is it okay to take
yes, sir.
Comments because they've been holding for quite a while.
Well, we got
a
chief on. Chief, what? We got a chief back with us. Chief, what you think?
No, oh, I think y'all keep doing what y'all been doing. That's okay. What I think.
Yes, sir. Okay, well, let's do this real quick. Zuberry, if you're on, please.
Thank you so much. Yes, Hotep.
Hotep, my brother.
Hotep.
All right, now. Listen, I just wanted to call in because I was listening, and it's a very interesting conversation for an individual who I believe is one of the most important leaders of our people, of the African people here in this country. And I was just want to say that years ago, you know, I came along listening to Malcolm, and he was so inspiring because, as you know, Malcolm, he transitioned the Islamic community And of course, I would go so far as to say that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad also, because I knew about him also, but it was so motivating. And for me, the significance of bringing a closure to the family and even to Malcolm, would, you know, and I don't want to get into religion, but whatever, wherever he might be, if he is still in this universe, that's kind of the way I believe. But the bottom line, though, is bringing a closure to this family. I mean, that has done so much for all of us African people here in this country and throughout the world, for that matter. And so to ask the question, how is this going to help us? It helps us in a lot of ways because, number one, it reveals the truth. And the truth has been hidden from us, of all people, for so long. And just to have our children and others understanding something about the enemy, those people who are trying to, who are holding us, are trying to hold us back, to understand the techniques that they're using, yes, and all of the other things that are going on with respect to that group of people. And so I just wanted to call in to say that I am so happy that this is going on, and so happy that this great man, Malik El-Shabazz, has known that this whole thing is now getting ready to go to court or do something to resurface. You know, it's a beautiful thing. And for us as African people to believe that it's inconsequential, it's like saying those four little children that were bombed up down in Birmingham, going after those people that did that, would be inconsequential. Or Emmett Till, you see what I'm saying? Or Martin Luther King. This is very significant, and I'm so happy that you guys have it on. And thanks so much for letting me get that in.
Thank you, Brother Zuberry. Appreciate it.
My man. Take care now.
Smoking Joe, you have a minute to get your comment in, sir. Thank you for holding.
Thank you for the show. Let me first say that we honor and thank Allah for the life of Brother Jabril because he was an amazing scholar. He was a friend of black people all around the earth. He was God's angel sent to aid Brother Mosque Maryam Muhammad, fearless servant, Minister Farrakhan, Brother Farrakhan. And for that, I always be thankful and grateful because if it wasn't for him working in obedience, we don't know where the nation might have been.
It wouldn't have been.
And if it had been lifted at that point in time. I wanted to say that. Two, I want to say that Brother Farrakhan, for those who are listening who don't know the importance of truth, I heard a caller who didn't understand the importance of Malcolm, the information on Malcolm being relevant today. Well, Mustafa like Muhammad, as well as Most Honorable Minister Farrakhan, said that truth is very vital. In fact, he was brought here to reveal truth, because the devil, his goal is to
keep people
in lies. And we have to understand our people have been tricked and lied to.
That's right.
This situation that we find our people in, there are many people are angry with killings and murders. This is some of this is by divine order.
Yes, sir.
This is all written in the book that these things will be happening at this time.
Yes, sir.
The devil, the enemy, is in his last days, and there are going to be many things that we're going to see that are going to be happening that we're going to disagree with. But know that and have faith that better times are coming.
Yes, sir.
And the truth must be revealed. For anybody who's revealing truth, knocking the brains out of falsehood and lies, yes, is doing the work of Allah.
Thank you, Brother Smoking Joe. And our last caller, Anita. Thank you all for holding. Anita, do you have a brief comment, ma'am?
Thank you for taking my call again. I really had a question. I've been worried about it because I think the government probably has something to do with it. And internationally, if Elijah Muhammad had really started working things out with the Saudis, I believe this country thought that they would arm us to come against this country and give us money, the restructure and everything. And you know the white Caucasian did not want that to happen, and nor did some of their allies.
That's absolutely, yes,
ma'am. Okay, including Israel.
Yes, ma'am.
They did not want that to happen, because then we would be the think tanks with money and military might, and they wanted to keep us, you know, and that's what I really think happened between the allies and the government. Nobody wanted that connection with Elijah Muhammad and Saudi Arabia. And then Trump's son-in-law has a connection with them now. And they're talking about they could bring the value of the dollar down to 10 cents with whatever they're doing.
Yes.
So, no, they did not want Elijah Muhammad to have that power. And to say him and his student pupil was a problem, that means throw the blame off of what they were doing to break it down so it couldn't happen. And Muhammad Ali was his, also was his student. He ain't trying to kill Muhammad Ali, okay. Elijah Muhammad.
Yes,
so,
ma'am.
I mean, he was just as big of a student as Malcolm X.
Yes, ma'am. All right, thank you, but Sister
anyway,
Anita. We really appreciate your call, and we want you to stay in touch with us, Brother Naba. We got Pastor Victoria. I wanted to know if you wanted to go ahead and, you know, take...
No, man, you keep on, but could I make one quick comment in terms of what Anita said?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
The Honorable Elijah Muhammad was very clear that our success was not in carnal weapons.
Right.
The government knew that. They knew that the FOI didn't carry weapons. But what they feared was the truth in the mouth of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the fearlessness that he put into his followers, the truth that he spoke, and this vision of black universal rise that he implanted in us. So we see ourselves not as American Negroes. We see ourselves as the original people of the planet, meaning we identify with the Dalits of India and their struggle.
Yep.
We identify with the black Rohingya Muslims and their struggle. We identify with the Aboriginals in Australia and their struggle. We identify with the struggle of our people in South America and Central America and Brazil. We identify with the struggle of black people in Africa. And we identify with the struggle of black people in Europe. That's why this teaching has continued to grow and expand and expound internationally. So every time you are speaking of the great Brother Malcolm, remember that he had a teacher.
Amen.
That teacher was the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Amen.
Okay, Brother James, I'm done,
sir.
Man. You can go on and do your thing.
Man.
I'm going to listen.
Every time you start talking, brother, I get to jumping up and down, man.
That's right.
We have our next guest, Pastor Victoria. I don't know. Are you there, Pastor?
Yes, I am. Love and peace. Can you hear me?
Yeah, loud and clear. Love and peace to you as well.
Somebody's got a radio in the background.
Yeah,
though,
we
that
hear
we
some
hear
background noise.
So we need to turn that radio down or whatever that is in the background.
Yes. Okay, that did it. How are you, sis?
I am blessed.
Yes.
I am tremendously blessed, and I am truly, truly grateful for the conversation that is going on this evening. I send love and greetings to my brother Naba and each and every one of you, my brother James Muhammad, and the entire Nation of Islam, all of God's children. Love and peace to you. I'm truly stirred up over here, excited, and I almost feel like don't want to break into the conversation, but we do have something we want to share that we believe will we believe to be a good thing for the city of Chicago, and particularly the young people of Chicago. So thank you so very much for this opportunity to join you this evening.
Well, Brother Naba spoke very highly of you, and the floor is yours. So what is the organization? What's going on? Tell us a little bit.
Yes, sir. So I am the second generation CEO of ABJ Civic Arts Center, an organization that was founded by my mother, Dr. Vivian Jones, back in 1993. We celebrated 30 years this year. ABJ started out as a social service organization, and upon my mother's retirement, I ended up taking the reins and I have now reshaped it into more of an arts and culture community empowerment center. And it really centers very heavily on young people and building peace in the community and really building inner tranquility and understanding our connectivity to one another. For the past year, we've worked on a film called that we eventually named The Other Side of Chicago. Mm. And this film is a documentary that really instills a sense of hope through the divine spirit of the Black community as we rise in unity. And this documentary traces the work that is being done on a daily basis in Chicago. I personally take issue with the stories and the lies and the narrative that is told of Chicago, when in fact, you all talked a lot about truth tonight, mm-hmm. and it is indeed the truth that makes us free. It is indeed, whether people like it or not, believe it or not, it is the truth that makes us free. And so the truth of the matter is that we are alive, we are active in Chicago, we are taking position, we are doing the work necessary to change our condition internally. We're working on reparations. I mean, there's no shortage of things that we're doing. And this film is exciting because we captured a lot of the work, and there's so much being done, so many great things. But this film is inspiring. It covers the work of youth, ministers, law enforcement, activists, big mamas in the community, all of us rising in the village to bring a more peaceful and safer and stronger Chicago. Mm-hmm. And so we're releasing this film on next Wednesday, August the 9th, which is actually my birthday. It's my gift to my people, to my community. And so we're releasing the film next Wednesday, August the 9th at the Chatham Theater, 6:00 p.m. It's a free event. We would love for people to come out and celebrate the great work that we're doing, how we are taking hold of our village, of our community. And it's no respecter of people. It's about us. It's the spirit of who we are, Muslim, non-Muslim, Hebrew, Christian, whatever form of denomination or whatever belief system we're in. We are brothers and sisters, and we want our young people to know that we are here. And we ain't going nowhere. So that's the short of it.
Yeah.
So, and I can pause for further comment or questions, but we're really excited about this project.
Yeah, I had a question. I had a couple of very questions. Number one, where is the name of your organization? Where is it located? And just in terms of the day-to-day things that you do, what is that like? So that people can get an idea, like if they walk in with their child or something, what is the experience going to be?
Okay, great question. First, I want to say that we are currently doing our program at Temple of Mercy Association, also called TOMA, and it's located at 616 East 71st Street. What happens with ABJ is that our young people, they come into their second home. They come into the village, and we offer them a range of programming, including trauma counseling and coaching, life coaching. We offer them music, culture. We have dance, all facets of arts. And what we're really after and what we're really pursuing is helping our young people to heal and to know the greatness that they are, who they are, from whence they come, and then to have them to become change agents in their own community, to become actively engaged in the community. And it's not saying that every young person is going to be a leader. We know that every young person is not necessarily going to be a leader, but each and every one of us can contribute. And we want our young people to know that they are part of a greater village that really, truly, we're such a spiritual and divine people, and our young people need to know that connection. They need to know who they're connected with. So they'll experience what we've seen, and this is the words of the young people themselves. they have been able to self-report that they have increased confidence. They know how to handle conflicts better. They have a better sense of their own worth. Some have improved in their academics. We've seen great gains in literacy and other subject matter. And so what we feel, you talked a little bit, one of the brothers, I'm not sure which one of you it was, but you talked about the resurrection of the mind. And so we feel in many, many ways, that's what we're doing. We're bringing a spark from the inside out, sparking a fire that's already there. And all it needs to do is be lit. All it needs is a little igniting, and it can take flame, and then it can become what it's supposed to become. So we work from the inside out of the person. But that's what they will experience. And I'm excited about this film because it talks about and it really demonstrates how we collaborate and the unity that we're building in the community. And when we unite, there's nothing that can overtake us. There's already nothing that can overtake us with God himself alone. However, right. God honors unity. And so when That's we look right. at this film, we're looking at unity. And I really want to emphasize that because we know we need unity. We talk about unity, but we need to do unity. You asked where we're located. I had a very traumatic experience as an executive director in a non-for-profit organization with ABJ. Brother Nava is very much aware of it, where we were literally pushed out of a building that we had been in for 22 years. I'm not bringing that up to say we're a victim. I'm bringing that up because it really, really taught me some powerful lessons. And one of part of the lesson is that we have to grow to become a community where an institution that is legitimately giving and giving and giving and sacrificing should not be able to be just overtaken in an instant. Unchallenged, you know, with an organization that's from the north side of Chicago just come in and decide they want the space and try to blame it, you know, blame it on money and rent and things like that. The point that I'm making, because again, I'm not trying to make this personal, but I am really strongly emphasizing how we cannot be overtaken in any regard when we truly unite. So that's what we want our young people to know, that we're here, we're united, we're working on being stronger as a unit, and we're working on rebuilding our own village. We need to do it ourselves, and we're the only ones that really can do it. And so this film, it's really a sight to see people that we did a private screening, and the feedback and the comments where people left inspired. They felt joyful. They felt hopeful. They want their young people to see it, the young people in their families. They feel like that they need to see this because we can't have young people to have the light go out in their eyes thinking That's right. that no one cares, there's nothing we really can do, it'll never change, oh, that's just the way it is. No. We can't sit back and have that happen. So ABJ is just doing our small part to make a difference, and we want to make a difference in a big way, and we feel that this film is a big part of our journey of redeveloping as a community.
Yes, ma'am. Brother Napa, you have anything? I got a couple more questions, but BJ or Napa?
Yeah, I was going to say, Sister Victoria, I'm so glad that this is coming out of the city of Chicago because there's so much negative publicity, and you don't think anything that's positive is coming out of the city. And, you know, with arts and culture, we could change the narrative about the way people think about our young people. And I think this could cause a revolution all over the country when people see this film. Is there one particular thing that you can say out of the film that people should look forward to with the messaging?
I would say when people look at the film, oh my, when you ask me that, I mean, it's almost like tears at the back of my eyes because I truly feel that in watching the film, and even as I watch it to review it and make sure everything is the way it needs to be, it is so touching, the passion that comes through that screen of these activists and ministers and big mamas and the good officers in our community, the love, it is so, it, the counselors, the people that speak in the film and the actions, the prayers that, that go forth and all the evidence of the work that's being done, the love and the passion and the divine spirit of God, it just jumps through the screen. And so it's love that covers a multitude of faults. It's love that makes us go above and beyond. It's love that'll even allow us to be assassinated. It's love that'll take us to the limits. And so that's what I feel is the message coming through the screen. And the message is, young people, even though the message is for everyone, it's young people, we love you. We have not that's thrown right. you away. We have not thrown you to the sad. Yeah. That's the message. So we love you.
Right. So in other words, people need to know they're not coming to see an episode of The Shot when they come see this.
Oh, no. No, no, sir. No, sir. No, no, sir. No, sir. No, sir. I mean, I like that. That was fun. But you know, but the young people will enjoy it because they'll see other young people. They'll see them dancing. They'll see them rapping. We just had a peace concert at the DuSable Museum. They'll get a chance to see some footage from young people that wrote their own music and got a chance to perform it. There are young people about to go to the recording studio. They're going to have a bona fide professional listening party. They'll get their own personal demos. I mean, the young people that come to see the film, their eyes will light up when they see the other young people and what they're doing, because we know that it's young people that reach young people. We know that for a fact. So, yes, I think that any and everyone that see this film, yes, sure, people can come and pick it apart and they can critique and all of those things. But the love and the passion and the true work, real work that happens every single day, is undeniable. And I dare anyone to challenge the work that we are actually doing in our own community. And you're right. This narrative has to go. Because it is simply not the truth. It is not the whole truth. And if it's not the whole truth, then it may as well not be the truth.
Come on.
Are there ages, the people, the young folks that can participate in your programs, is there age limits or is it just from certain age all the way
up? Well, we have two programs. We have two programs. And one program is for ages 10 years old, which is like sixth grade. We have an ABJ Freedom School program, and the Freedom School program starts at sixth grade, which they're roughly like 10 years old up to 13 years old. And then we have a teen program that goes actually up through the millennial age range. So it goes from 14 to up to 35. But of course, the programming is sectioned by age brackets. They're not, you know, we have an ABJ Millennial Tribe. And the millennial tribe, by and large, are members of our program that became adults and they wanted to stay connected to the organization. So we developed the millennial tribe to have them have a way to stay connected, be involved in the programs, help develop programs, come back and mentor and things like that. So all together, we go from ages like roughly 10 years old up to 35. But by us being an arts and culture organization, we do a lot of intergenerational work. We do plays and concerts, and we just did a really beautiful African-based classical music event. And I know Minister Farrakhan loves the classical music as well. And so there are things that we do that can go up to 80 years old, 85 years old. But our base, though, is the young adult, is the teenager. Yeah, that's the hub of ABJ's programming, is the teenager. But we go a little lower, and then we also go a little bit higher depending on what project we're working on.
Yeah, so you said 35. That means I can come over and get involved in a program. So that's good to know.
You can come and do the ABJ Civic Arts Circle. You can sit in our circle with us, our healing circle, our peace circle. You can come in and contribute. and help us build this village and this community? You absolutely can. Okay. Yes, you can.
Well, tell me a little bit about, or us a little bit about, the process of bringing the documentary into being. I don't know if you are a film producer. What was that experience? How did you make it happen?
That's a great question. I'm actually a singer. I am not a filmmaker. I am a singer and I'm a playwright. My passion is musical theater, and I have a pretty strong background in musical theater. And I found out by being cast in a play many, many years ago. I was cast in a play called The Great Nitty Gritty that was written by Oscar Brown Jr. And I was sitting, there was a scene that we were doing, and it was like I was an ensemble member at that moment, and I was watching a scene, and as I was sitting there watching the scene, I had an epiphany, and I really came to life, because it was in The Great Nitty Gritty that I found out that I don't have to be just an entertainer, like, here just to entertain people. There's nothing wrong with entertainment, but I knew that that's not what I wanted. And I found out from being in that play that I could do art that could make a difference, art that can inspire people and make people, you know that there's hope and there's a better way for them. So all that being said, I've been working in the community for many, many years now here in Chicago, where I was born and raised. And I've worked with young people, and I see the plight of the young person. I talk to young people pretty much on a daily basis. I see what they go through. And I also am very much aware of the agenda that's set against us and the narrative that permeates throughout our community. I'm aware of all of those things. And to be honest with you, I just wanted to do something about it. And it's like, no, that's not, you know, God has given me this assignment of unity. And Brother Naba, we've done some projects together, so he really knows. But there's this this anointing on my life and on me that says that your role is to help bring people together. And so the best way that I know to bring people together, aside from the Word of God, is the arts. And I was doing some work with the 3rd District Police, and you know the relationship with the police and the Black community is horrible. And I did a film a few years ago called Bridge in the Divide, where I showed how ministers and police officers and the community, and including youth, are working together. The film went over very well. It was very well received. And I just started thinking that, you know, looking at the news every day, which I don't look at anymore, but I used to look at the news all the time. Yeah. And there was never anything good. There was never anything positive. There was nothing. I mean, you might see a duck. They may capture a duck walking across the street and make a big deal out of it, but we don't see anything that we're doing as good. But a duck can be covered.
An alligator in the lake over by the DuSable Museum gets a
whistle. You know, right. Covered. Craziness like that. So I just felt like, you know, we have these tools available, and it's like, tell your story, put it on the screen. We met this woman from Israel. I believe it's Israel. It might not be Israel, but they call it the Middle East, but she's from the Middle East. And she came and did an interview of some of us in the community that's in my network. She interviewed us, and she was really, I mean, all she really could say and talk about and refer to was negative things. She had no knowledge of who we really are and what we really do. And so, my brother, I just wanted to do something about it. It's like, that's not the whole of it. And so I will admit that we got a grant, we got a state grant, and I put in the grant that we were going to create a village environment for our young people, and that we were going to work on the documentary for a full year, and that we were going to release it into the community. And that's exactly what we're doing. We've taken the program, and the young people have their help. They did some of the videography, some of the editing, some of the narration. They're featured in the film, and it's just a journey that I'm on to use. You know, there's some, you know how you take what you, they say that Arthur Ashe made a comment, use what's in your hand. So that's all I did, is I just used what's in my hand, so to speak. I used what's available to me to know that we are here on this planet and we are alive and well, and God ain't through with us yet as a matter of speaking. And that's not just a cliche. That's real talk. You know, he's not through with us yet. He's not through with us as a people. And so that's what led me to want to do this film, because our people, including our young people, they need to know that these people are right here in Chicago. We are right here, and we are working every day to, and I know we have a long way to go. We have things, a challenge ahead, but we are here, and we continue to do the work. So that's what led to that.
Students were part of the writing and the filming as well?
Yes, we have film and editing, and they're learning how to do podcasts. One song that's featured in the film was written by two brothers. It's called I'm So Hot, Can't Put Out the Fire. And we're looking to take them into the recording studio. They've already gone once, but we want to give them a demo of it that they can use. And then the narrator, she's a bright, beautiful, beautiful young lady. I believe she's maybe 20 years old now. And she's really familiar with how to do hosting. She used to host another internet show. So she does a lot of the narration. And then there's another young lady that does some of the video, and she's learned how to edit. So yeah, we have several of them that's involved in different aspects of the film. And then again, as I said, when we did the peace concert recently, we had almost all of our young people perform, and so there'll be footage from their performances. And we had some young people that worked behind the scenes. They were like stage managers and things like that, because they're not necessarily artistically inclined. But we find a way to engage every single young person in every single project that we do. Nobody gets a free pass at ABJ. Everybody has to contribute something.
Okay. So the film.
And I would love to give you our website as well, if I may.
I dare you to give us your website.
Okay. Well, double dog dare me. It's www. abjchicago.org, and that's A Apple B Boy J Jack, www.abjchicago.org. And for the film, we're asking people to register, because there's limited seating at the Chatham Theater, the theater that we are renting out.
Okay.
It's limited seating, so please get your reservation in. It's free, don't cost you anything.
Wow.
We just want to come out and celebrate as a village, and we would love to see you at the event.
August,
you know,
the 9th,
you'll hear
Wednesday,
other things
August
about the,
9th.
The film. Yeah. I'm sorry, can you say it again?
Wednesday, August the 9th, right?
Oh, yes, 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 sir. Yes,
what time,
my brother.
What time?
The doors will open at 6 p.m.
6 p.m. Okay.
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sorry. Go ahead. What were you going to say?
I think I was just saying about registering and making sure that, because it's going to be limited seating, and we just want to have people come out and just celebrate the truth about Chicago. And we understand that there's so much that we didn't get a chance to cover, but it's still a proud moment for us. This film represents the work of all of our people that are serious and really authentically wanting to make a difference. This film, it represents every single person, every single thing that we're doing, every effort that's being made. And it's encouraging all of us to keep on keeping on and never give up, because we're going to make it.
That's right.
Yes, ma'am.
Well, thank you, sister, for sharing that information. And we want to make sure everybody gets out there August the 9th for the screening of The Other Side of Chicago.
Yes, sir.
And yes,
so
the
much,
other side of Chicago.
Yeah, that's
well, thank you,
Chatham,
my brothers. And
Chatham Theater on August
yes.
the 9th. Okay, 6 o'clock.
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yes, it is. Well, I really just as I close out, I know you have to go, but I want to say thank you so very much. And I want to thank the final call the final call has been following ABJ's work for almost all of our history of 30 years, almost that entire history. The final call has been a friend to ABJ. The minister, through many associations that I have, I just feel so very blessed, and I'm very, very grateful for who you are and all that you're doing to make a difference for our people. So God bless you, and thank you again so much for the opportunity.
God bless you. Thank you, all right. Pastor Victoria Brady. That's The Other Side of Chicago, a documentary, August 9th at 6 p.m. at Chatham Theater up on 87th and the Dan Ryan. Everybody should go. It's free. Go online at www.abjchicago.org to register. Thank you, Pastor Brady.
And let me just clarify, www.abjchicago.org, www.abjchicago.org. I'm getting out your way, my brothers. I know you have much left to do. No, God bless you. Thank you. Love and peace.
God bless you. Yes. Thank you. All right, brothers. We had a good show tonight. Brother Nabar, thank you for joining us, brother. I'm glad. You know, I know you couldn't see me when you heard Dr. Wesley on.
No, man. You know, I think I'm going to have to stop playing and just ask Brother Wesley when he come on if he could just come on for 90 minutes. Because exactly. There's never right. enough time. Exactly. You know what I mean?
Exactly. Right. Yeah.
But y'all did a great job tonight, man. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Well, we got a few more minutes, well, Brother Napa. Is there? I mean, I guess Brother BJ, we got a few more minutes to the top.
Yeah, anything you wanted. You didn't get a chance to expound on the janazah prayer service. I'd like to hear what you thought about it. What the minister had to say.
Brother, it was so wonderful, masterful, insightful, and uplifting. And one of the things that the minister said that he said before, but he's one of the things that he mentioned, he said, I'm paraphrasing him, we have been so mistaught by the enemy that we take prophecy to be history, and we take history to be prophecy. And so we needed someone that would come and unravel that and put us in the right space so that we wouldn't be looking back 2,000 years. We would be looking for someone in the present that matched a description that was given 2,000 years ago. But I thought it was a great, it was a great, great message. And, you know, to have a tribute to Brother Jabril, I thought Brother Wesley, of course, was great. Sister Victoria was great. Mona Harden, the mother of Ronald Green, couldn't make it tonight, and neither could a couple of our other guests. But inshallah, we'll try to have them on maybe next week to keep that case fresh, you know. But brothers, I mean, this was, we got to just keep on what we're doing, and we need to get some money to do that, Brother BJ.
Well, that's right.
We need the money.
Mention where to send the money to.
Yeah.
Right. Brother BJ.
And you can send it to the Cash App, Brother James, $StraightWords on Cash App, $StraightWords on Cash App, on Zelle, 312-480-9775. That's 312-480-9775. And on PayPal, StraightWords, the number 4, @gmail.com, because we're paying for this show, brothers and sisters, to have this 3 hours. And, you know, the minister taught us that the airwaves are sacred. And when you're listening to what we're talking about, this is sacred information that's going out over the airwaves that it's giving somebody life. It's feeding the soul of brothers and sisters who maybe just happen to pass by the dial and they hear the A-tone. They get an electrical impulse by hearing the truth of what's coming through the radio on Tuesday evening between 9 p.m. and midnight. And one thing the minister said that I loved from the lecture he did was he said, in a divine work, everybody got to know their place.
Yes.
Go ahead, man.
Everybody got to know their place in a divine work. And we believe that the work of the resurrection of the dead is a divine work, and all of us are trying to play our role And when I think about that statement, I think about the both of you, and I think about the former editors that have gone on before you, and of course, Sister Starla, that you brothers and sisters play the role of angels to me, because, you know, you got to be a special type of human being to print a paper like the Final Call newspaper every week. It's magnificent. And I just want to say that to y'all, brothers, because y'all need to hear that.
Yes, sir.
I really, really appreciate that. And all the brothers and sisters all over the country appreciate the work. It ain't lightweight.
No, it's a heavy responsibility.
You know, this is heavy duty. Y'all some heavy hitters, man. No,
you're representing the word of the Messiah, man. You know,
right, come
this
on.
This is not no lightweight publication. Years from now, I mean, actually, you could just go ahead and read scripture and read about what's happening now. But, you know, years from now, those who reflect on this time period will understand how the scripture just walked through the 18th, the 19th, and the 2000s, and how that man or those men, the three, the Trinity, kind of ushered in a new world, because that's what we're looking at. We're looking at the collapse of an old world and the creation of a brand new world, where the cornerstone of this brand new world will be the stone that the builders have rejected. Pookie, Ray Ray, Jaquita, they're going to be the cornerstone, man. You know,
that's right.
And that's the process that we're going through of being cleansed. The one brother asked about, you know, he implied like we don't need to know the history about Malcolm and why, you know, what difference will it make? What's basically he was asking, maybe unsaid, what's the nation doing? He don't know about the study guides that Minister Jabril was instrumental in starting. But now how the Honorable Minister Farrakhan's study guides every Friday, we're talking about developing yourself so that you can develop community. Development starts with yourself. If you ain't no good, right, your community, your environment ain't going to be no good. If you
That's
ain't
right.
no good when you walk past your house, it's going to tell a story about how no good you are, because you are is reflective of you. So, you know, that's the focus right now, is to not only our community, but it starts with ourselves. And that's the kind of study the Honorable Minister Farrakhan has all of us in. Yeah, so.
Yes, sir. So we're wrapping things up.
Yep.
Brothers and sisters, thank you all for listening. And we're going to be back with you on next Tuesday. Don't forget, you can donate $StraightWords on Cash App. 312-480-9775 on sale, and on PayPal, StraightWords4@gmail.com. The scripture says, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Go out there and be a child of God this week. Peace, y'all.
Nah, but we'll be back next week, inshallah.
Yes, sir.
Is 1690 WVON, Berwyn, Chicago.
Dad! Come on! Over here! Look at this, Dad! Over! Whoa!
The moment my son saw a redwood tree.
It's huge!
Is the moment I knew that for him.
You can't even see the top of that thing.
Even the sky has no limit.
There are some moments only the forest can inspire. Find yours at discovertheforest.org. Learn about forests near you and discover cool things to do when you go, like hiking, biking, fishing, or camping. Or do your own thing when you get there with family and friends. Your moment is out there. Find it at discovertheforest.org. That's discovertheforest.org. www.gov't.org.
Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
President Donald Trump has been indicted for election interference that culminated with the January 6, 2021 Capitol riot. Prosecutors say his efforts to overturn the 2020 presidential election contributed to the riot. Trump is expected to be arraigned in the case on Thursday. And that's the latest. I'm Esther Dillard from the Black Information Network and BINnews.com.
I'm Vanessa Tyler.
And I'm Mike Stevens on your home for 24/7 News, the Black Information Network.
The legal hammer has dropped on Donald Trump.
Today, an indictment was unsealed, charging Donald J. Trump with conspiring to defraud the United States, conspiring to disenfranchise voters, and conspiring and attempting to obstruct an official proceeding.
That's special counsel Jack Smith. This indictment for election interference, Trump lost but lied, leading to the January 6th riot, although Trump was not charged with that. Legal observers say this case is strong.
This is the most serious case that has been brought against Donald Trump, and for one simple reason. It involves an allegation that the former president, when he was president, tried to subvert the peaceful transfer of power.
Assigned to preside over this case, a black woman, Obama-appointed Judge Tanya Chutkan, Trump due in court Thursday. This is the ex-president's third indictment, and another one is looming, election interference in Georgia. Trump dismisses it as an un-American witch hunt.
There's shock and mourning in New Jersey. The state's lieutenant governor has died one day after going into the hospital. African-American Sheila Oliver made history and broke glass ceilings. She also was the first black state assembly speaker. Born and raised in Newark, New Jersey, she dedicated 40 years to public service. The Democrat was loved and respected on both sides of the aisle.
And I was totally in shock. Sheila was a wonderful person. She helped so many. And I was so proud of her when she made the first black lieutenant governor. I was very proud.
She was acting governor while Phil Murphy is out of the country in Italy on vacation. The Senate president has stepped in now. Oliver has had health issues. Black lieutenant governor Sheila Oliver, dead at 71. It's 2023, but two black men say it felt like 1953 when a bus driver ordered them to the back of the bus. They were headed to downtown Fargo, North Dakota. They say the bus was empty when the white driver demanded they move and threatened to call cops if they didn't. The bus company, Jefferson Lines, reportedly responded, "There may be unique circumstances when a driver would ask a passenger to move, like for an elderly or disabled person." But the black men say that was not the case, and again, the bus was empty.
But in this case, a black woman refused to move, and it was 1944, back when blacks had to. We remember Irene Morgan Kirkcaldy. She was on a Greyhound bus. She argued she paid her ticket and was in the colored section when a white couple needed a seat. The driver told her and a black woman holding a baby to get up. She took her case against segregation and interstate travel up to the Supreme Court. One of her attorneys, a young Thurgood Marshall, and she won. This was 11 years before Rosa Parks. I'm Vanessa Tyler with Mike.